days, God, we're going to get started in the Word. Thank y'all for coming this evening. And we're going to start over here in John chapter 8. John chapter 8.
8.
They're fine. All right, sorry. Yeah, this is Jesus Christ speaking to the Jewish people that was believing on him. And he asked them what they needed to do in order to continue as his disciples. John chapter 8, verse 30 says that. And as he spoke these words, many believed on him. So then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed. And you will know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. So here Jesus speaking to a people that encouraging them what they need to do in order to become his students. That's what a disciple is, a student, that they need to do what? Continue in his word. Amen. Continue in the word that they hear, heard that him speaking and so forth. And as we have opportunity to do so, because we have the Bible before us, to continue in the word. In doing so, we become his disciple. We become students of the word of God. And a process started taking place in verse 32. It says, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The word make there is a word that's saying it's going to start molding you and shaping you. So it's a thing that will go into motion as we are desiring the truth of the word of God to continue being in front of our eyes and going through our ears and dropping into our spirit life. And it says you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. So speaking about truth there, that's able to make and shape and mold you, the word make. And then it's also speaking in a sense where it's going to challenge things in your life that's not of God, things that are a lie, things that will open up doors to deceptions and so forth. So as we're looking into the word of God, it challenges things in our life that's not of the kingdom of God. And if we will do what we know we're supposed to do, turn away from it, change our mind about it, repent, get out of covenant with it, it will start making, shaping, and molding us into what God wants us to be as we're here on this earth. So we can have power over the works of darkness. That's Jesus Christ's desire. It's for us to have power over the enemy of our soul. In John chapter 1 John chapter 3, in verse 8, it says, he that commits sin is of the devil. So it's talking about those who continue committing sin. He's speaking to believers. If you continue committing sin, then basically you're going to start opening up doors for the enemy to continue coming back into your life. So now as believers, we have the opportunity to start allowing the word of God to shape and mold us and challenge error in our life, lies in our life, by bringing the truth as we continue looking in the word of God. And it's going to break the power of sin over our life. It says, but it says, he that committed sin is of the devil, for the devil sins from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. So destroying the works of the devil, Jesus Christ is manifested for. And taking that verse in John chapter 8, verse 32, that we will know the truth and the truth will make us free, then the truth that we're going to be taking in is going to be destroying any of the works of the devil that may be in our life after we accept Jesus Christ into our life. That may be still there, that the enemy's looking to reinstate different areas of himself back into our life. But as we continue looking into the word, hearing the word, it will challenge the enemy's lies, enemy's error that he has set up in our life before We ask Jesus Christ into our life. And we have to continue in the Word in order for it to make us, shape us into the freedom that we're supposed to be walking in now. So you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. For this purpose, Jesus Christ came into the world that he might destroy the works of the devil. And he's speaking about the spirit of truth, which he identified the Holy Spirit as being the spirit of truth when he told the disciples over there in John chapter 14. Over there he says, I'm going to send you the spirit of truth. That is the Holy Spirit. The spirit of truth to you now, speaking to his disciples. And if he's the spirit of truth, he's in our life for the purpose to deal with lies and error that's in our life. So in John chapter 8 again, Jesus Christ was having this confrontation with the religious leaders of that day, and they was accusing him, they literally was calling him an illegitimate child, a bastard, and so forth. And he was contending with them concerning who he was, him being the Messiah and all, identified who their father was. So they was trying to call him a bastard. So he started identifying who their father was. In John chapter 8, verse 36, we start at 36, says, If the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. It says, I know that you are Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me, because my words have no place in you. So this is telling us that the Word of God, if we don't diligently go after it as we're supposed to, as becoming disciples, that as these religious leaders of Jesus' day, Jesus is telling them that his words can't find a place in them. Can God's Word find a place in you? And we got to let, if God's words find that place in you, then it will bring forth the change or make or mold and shape us into what God has called us to be. So Jesus tells these religious leaders, I know that you are Abraham's seed, physical seed, but you seek to kill me because my words have no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my Father. And you do that which you have seen with your father. So Jesus is speaking about his father, God, and their father, Satan. Because God's words cannot find a place in them because they had sold their life over to Satan and didn't even realize it. They answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Jesus said unto them, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. But now you seek to kill me, a man that have told you the truth. Says, which I have heard of God. Says, this did not Abraham. Abraham wasn't going against what God's word, he's saying. Says, you do the deeds of your father, he tells them. Then said they to him, We be not born of fornication. So they're trying to say that Jesus is Mary committed fornication. That's how he got birthed into the earth. We have our Father, even God. Jesus said unto them, if God were your Father, you would love me, for I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of my own, but he sent me. So we know how when Gabriel stood before Mary and said she was chosen by God, that he came from the throne room of God with this message for Mary, and she accepted the Mary, and she accepted the message, and the Spirit of God went into her, and Jesus Christ started being formed in her womb. So God is his Father, he's explaining to them. Why do you not understand my speech? Even because you cannot hear my words. You are of your father, the devil. He started speaking plain English to them now. of your father, the devil. Says, and the lusts of your father that you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks of his own. It says, for he is a lie and the father of it. So we've seen in 1 John chapter 3, verse 8, he who sins is of the devil. That's why John is declaring that, because he heard this speech from Jesus Christ to a religious leader, that if we choose now, after being believers, accepting Jesus Christ into our life, if we choose to continue allowing lies and error to be in our life, then we're giving the enemy's place again into our life. But now, as believers, we have the power to, in Christ, to start letting the Holy Spirit point out different things in our life. That's an error. That's a lie. That's not true. And if God's going to point it out, and if we turn away from it, confess it, you know, it could be something that we've been believing in a certain way that we've been going all of our life. But now the Holy Spirit is trying to tell us that we're going the wrong way. We're going in the wrong direction. And so when we ignore that, then we start back taking on the characteristic of the father of lies. We've been birthed out of his kingdom as children of God. So I'm just speaking in the sense of trying to throw some knowledge at you right now concerning the principles in the Word of God. Going over to Hosea. Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. The book of Hosea, minor prophet in the Bible. God used Hosea to demonstrate to the children of Israel that he was married to them, but they had went astray from him and started committing spiritual adultery towards him. And he made Hosea go out and marry a prostitute to illustrate what they was doing to him by worshiping false gods and so forth. Where it says in Hosea chapter 4, verse 6, says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because you have rejected knowledge, I will also reject you, that you shall be no priest to me, seeing you have forgotten the law of your God. I will also forget your children. So this verse is turning to not just God rejecting them, but God rejecting their children. It becomes a generational type curse thing. But here in the New Testament, we could come to seeking God in a way of wanting to know the truth by searching out scriptures, and allowing the truth to change our heart by allowing it to deal with different errors, lies, and situations in our life. It will start molding and shaping us into the freedom that Jesus Christ said we could be walking in. But we got to be a people that's desiring to have the knowledge of the Word of God. It's not speaking about the knowledge of the world. It's talking about God's knowledge that comes by way of revelation and illumination and brings liberation into areas of our soul that it could happen no other way. My people are destroyed. So we are God's people. And God is, as here in the Old Testament, speaking about his people, that is allowing the environment where they're living cause them to start practicing the things that they was doing in that environment. You know, a lot of people are born into a certain environment that they already have some type of different type of practices going on. Some people are transferred to one place or another into another environment, not really understanding the culture and stuff that they're going into, and the power of the principality spirit that's over that community or what have you, and the demons that's working there to bring people in deeper and deeper darkness. And we don't go with the knowledge of the Word of God to the places that God is leading us to go, then we could fall prey to what's taking place in that community. You could fall prey to it, because it's only through knowledge that the just is delivered. And the enemy knows this, and he knows God's principle is that my people are destroyed because of lack of knowledge. That's not saying we don't have knowledge. It's saying that we're not seeking after it, right? Or going after it the way God wants us to, so he could enlighten us. Because you have rejected knowledge. He says, I will also reject you. So it's an automatic thing that takes place here. You know, you don't, you want to remain in darkness. Darkness is ignorance. A light is knowledge. Light is the revelation of the Word of God that God is unveiling to you, knocking darkness out of your soul, knocking ignorance out of your soul, towards Him, towards God, the Holy Spirit, and Jesus Christ, His finished work on the cross. So see, this verse carries a generational consequence that it caused God to start rejecting your children. And from there, I'm going to go over to Deuteronomy. In Deuteronomy chapter 18, starting at verse 9, remember this is God giving Moses the governmental laws before he takes the children of Israel into the promised land that he had promised for them, promised Abraham that he was going to take them into after 400 years of being in captivity to the, after 400 years and them being in Egypt turned into a captivity because a king raised up that didn't remember or didn't know what Joseph had done and put the children of Israel into captivity. Caused them to become slaves. And God raised up Moses, performed the miracles, parted the Red Sea, brought them out of Egypt, killed that king, that wicked king, and his army. And all the nations of the known world in that area heard about it, that God, this mighty God, with a mighty hand, has brought his people out of Egypt. But before God was going to take them into the promised land that he promised for them, he needed to give them governmental laws. It's a place where God is taking them that he wanted them to go and represent him by keeping his laws. And in the same way as God brought us out of our own personal Egypt, wherever we are in life, wherever he places, wherever we end up at, we're supposed to be representing the kingdom of God. And walking in authority and power of it. If not, you will be subdued by what's already established in that nation. As he's given them the governmental laws for them to operate up under when they go into this nation, he's telling them right here what's in this nation you're going into. And basically, if you don't walk the way he's telling you to walk, the power, the spiritual power, is going to overpower you and cause you to do the same thing that he hates. In verse 9 of Deuteronomy chapter 18 says, when you come to the land which Jehovah your God gives you, you shall not learn to do according to the abominations of these nations. It says, there shall not be found amongst you anyone that makes his son or his daughter to pass through the fire, or that use divination, an observer of clouds, or a fortune teller, or a witch, or a charmer, or a counselor with familiar spirits, or a wizard, or one who calls to the dead. For all that do these things are an abomination to Jehovah. I like this translation. So here's saying that God is laying it before them, this land is taking them into, what they're doing in the land right now that's causing God to hate them with a severe hate that he wanted everybody in the land destroyed. They're sacrificing their children into the fires up on the altars of their gods that they worship. They was committing all type of lascivious acts, perverted acts, bestiality acts, and it was commonplace that the spirit that had control over these people, the demonic spirits that was saturated in their life for the last 400 years. They never called upon God, but it's in every person to find something to worship. That's the way God made us all. He made us all with an empty box for himself inside of our hearts, our souls, our spirit. So all of mankind on earth right now is trying to find something to fill that void in their heart. and they turned to different gods, different deities, worshiping different things, being addicted to that, being addicted to this, putting all this stuff before God becomes a god. And so here God is telling them that the things that they is doing in the land, the things that he hates so bad, and they, everything they're doing is set up at an altar of some sort where it opens up a spiritual porthole to let demons in. And he gave them the way that they should worship him. And as they did the way that Moses told them, the way that God wanted to be worshipped, that spiritual altar that they was at will open up the spiritual door for God to come into their life and be a part of their life. If they did everything he asked them to do. So we're just going to dissect these verses and see how they may be applying to our lives right now, and maybe swallowing us up in whatever environment that we have landed in, whatever place that we're living in, that we didn't go there understanding that we're supposed to be representing the kingdom of God and doing everything that we know that we should have been doing before we came to a type of environment, especially like an environment like Wilmington. I've been here, living here all my life. I know the magnitude of the demonic spirits that is over Wilmington, that saturated people's life, because I was a part of it. Now, I'm just going to go back through these verses and sort of dissect them a little bit in another way that may apply to us today. It says, when you come to the land, or in our case, to the city, which Jehovah your God gives you. I would say, as God's people, the place we end up at, it is the place that God wants us to represent his kingdom here on earth. As believers, everywhere we go, we got to have that mindset that I'm here to represent the kingdom of God. It tells us that we are ambassadors from heaven now. It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, where it says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. All things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. All these things are of God, who have reconciled us unto himself and has given us a ministry of reconciliation. Therefore, you are ambassadors of God. So everywhere we go for representing the kingdom of God, because we've been doing what? Being students of the word of God, knowing the truth and allowing the truth to make us and shape us and mold us into the freedom to represent God wherever we go. And if that's taking place in your life, wherever you go, the spiritual climate that's there will be parted. Because the power of God is not just working in you, but working through you. As Moses took the children of Israel out of Egypt and he parted the Red Sea, because of the power of God was working in him. And as we go forth in this world, that we are not of the world no more, we're pilgrims just passing through, the Bible calls us ambassadors here to represent the kingdom of God. So wherever we are, we're supposed to be doing the things that's bringing forth the kingdom of God out of our lives. So going to say, you shall not learn to do. So wherever you go, you can learn to start doing the things they do there instead of causing whoever you can to start doing the things of the kingdom that you came, that you are here representing. So if you don't have this mindset of wherever you go, then you're going to be sucked into the negative climate that's already there, that's already cultivated, that's looking to draw people into it and cause them to do the same thing. And let me say, as I heard this guy from Big Bang say, it's a trap. It's a trap. It's seriously, it's a trap. A Christian don't go representing God wherever you go, then you're going to fall into the trap. You see, if I go somewhere, you know, if I go out of the country, go to another state or something, I'm going representing God. There ain't no places I'm going to go and probably just do a vacation. I'm going to go there because I'm representing God. I'm going to be passing out tracts. I'm going to be witnessing. I'm going to be trying to go preach at a mission somewhere or preach at a church somewhere. I'm going to be representing the kingdom of God. But I just go there and case Shirah, Shirah, whatever will be, I may come back with something. So as Christians now, not just because I'm a minister, because I'm a Christian, because I'm a believer, I have to be aggressive, not a sloppy, crazy, get away from me aggressiveness, but being led by the Holy Spirit. Okay. So you shall not learn to do. He's talking about something, says you intentionally train yourself to do. So if you're not going to, you know, to be wherever you go, the leader, and set the strain, set the example of how you want things to be around you, then something else is going to step up and lead you. And that's just the way of life. And see, the things depending on what type of climate you go into, and you can take the same climate that you came out of into that climate. And things could snowball and even get worse. But it's only because of God in our life now that we could turn it around for good, or it could be turned around for good. But just as God told the children of Israel, before you go into the land, do not learn to do. Talking about something you intentionally train yourself to do. And they did. They went in that land and eventually they stopped doing what God told them to do and started doing what the people of the land was doing, the same people who they destroyed. And after they destroyed all the people, guess what's still there? The demons that caused them to do it in the first place. And as long as they abide by God's way, when they went into that land, I was saying for us, when we go into a city or wherever we're going, Lord, we're going to represent the kingdom of God, then we are standing with the enemy up under our feet. We're seated in heavenly places in Christ, representing Jesus Christ. But when we go in there, case Sarah, Sarah, and don't want to represent the kingdom, then the enemy is looking to put his feet on your head and put you up under his feet and take you down lowest possibly that he can. And don't think he don't have no power to do so. Jesus says in telling his disciples concerning the enemy when they came back rejoicing in Luke chapter 10, verse 19, he said, I give unto you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. So the enemy has power. Jesus said, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means harm you. So when we're walking in that going power that Jesus Christ called us to go in, then Jesus said, nothing by any means will harm you. That isn't saying he won't try to harm you. But we are understanding some things and walking in the victory and not in ignorance and darkness, but in revelation and light. So, learn to practice to do some things. Say it like that. Then it goes on to say, you shall not learn to do according to the abominations of those nations. Or according to the abominations, I will say, of the wicked and evil practices of the people, says, that was in that city before you. That was in that place before you. There's a wicked evil practice already established everywhere. Already established. So we as the children of God, you know, the people of God, that God brought us all out of our own personal Egypt. And the enemy sees, just as the enemy seen how God brought the children of Israel out of that physical Egypt. And when they got into the promised land, and the spies was, the second set of spies, when Joshua took them in, was talking to Rahab, And she says that the fear of God is upon everybody in this nation because of him bringing you out of Egypt. She told him that. And still today, if we're walking in that power and in the image and likeness of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as we should be walking in, wherever we go, the fear of the enemy is there. The fear of the enemy, not us fearing him, but him fearing us. Because we have the power to deal with him, have the power to cast him out. Cast him out of whatever situation that he have arranged anywhere. And we need to start learning to walk in that power. That's why I preach the way I preach and try to teach the way I teach, because there's a power, especially in these end times that we're living in, that we're supposed to be walking in. And if we don't learn to walk in it, then there's some things that's going to be walking over us real soon. I keep saying the end times, and we are truly in the end times. And the enemy is any day now, there could be this chaos. They have different things that they could do right now, high technology, spiritual things that the enemy is doing right now. And with the help of mankind and mankind's technology that mankind is yielding to, there's people in high office and in the military and stuff that yield to the enemy. I want to look at, see if I can find this verse real quick. John chapter 12, verse 31. I think it's John chapter 12, verse 31. Or 32. Yeah, 31. John chapter 12, verse 31 says, "Now is the judgment of the world. Now shall the prince of the world be cast out," Jesus declared. Now, because why? This new dispensation we're going into that Jesus Christ is saying that is going to take place. Now the prince of the world and everything up under him, Satan, his fallen angels, the demons that work for him, they could be cast out. They weren't able to be cast out in the Old Testament, but now they can be cast out. And we're not doing, you know, the principal thing in the Word of God to stand against the enemy and cast him out. Then guess what? He's staying. So we get to the place to cast him out. We can do that now here in the New Testament. But we have to walk a certain way before God. Walk in the victory that God has already placed for us to walk in. So, concerning the nations, according to the abomination of those nations, it says in Deuteronomy chapter 18. My note says, according to the abominations of the wicked and evil practices of the people that was in that city before you. So we're trying to help us to see that we're supposed to be walking above wherever we go. Above the wicked practices of the city that was there before you got there. But if we're not being careful, Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, that we should be sober. That means to have well thought out thoughts. Vigilant. Says, "For your adversary, the devil, walks about seeking whom he may devour." As lying, it says, is walking about seeking whom he may devour. So he's telling us to have well thought out thoughts concerning what? The knowledge of God, the spiritual aspect that God is trying to lead us to understand, because the enemy at this time, he's leading people to understand the spiritual realm really clearly. And that, you know, there's power in the spiritual realm that can move things in the natural realm. If it's working through a human being, just as God wanted to be saturated with him, because there's power with God that will move things here in this physical realm. The enemy has his soldiers set up, physical people. set up, moving things in the physical realm with spiritual power. So it goes on to tell them, there shall not be found amongst you anyone who makes his son or his daughter pass through the fire. And understanding how this could be related to us in the day that we're living in, this can also be someone who has lost their spiritual authority over their children. Person who lost their spiritual authority over their children because they didn't even know they had spiritual authority. They wasn't what? Walking in the truth of the Word of God. They weren't allowing the Word of God to make shape and form them into God helping them to understand that the spiritual is more affected than the physical realm. And so therefore, people forget about God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit and His angels and just live this physical life and lose the spiritual authority over their children. And this is what the enemy wants us to do. People to remain a people lacking knowledge. Then, and it says, are that use divination. This is speaking about the many different ways that a person could enter into the spiritual realm. Divination is like all the little things dating from the games that people play to the cartoons that kids watch to the movies that's coming out in the days that we're living in and all the different types of high-graded games that people buy and play. I remember one time when I was on the grooming shop and right around the corner was a thrift store, St. Plaza. This one girl goes over there and she sees a Ouija board and she buys it. And she started to bring it into my shop. I'm like, what is that? Yeah. And I'm like, no. Get that thing out of my shop. Like, why? Because they're ignorant, right? Ignorant to what? This thing is a spiritual door that's going to let demon in. And I'm letting it know right away that I'm not accepting it. Not that they were going to play it or anything. If they could have, I would have just at, you know, sarah, that ain't nothing. They would have, the bathers would have been back there playing with the Ouija board all up in the shop. And it's a spiritual porthole that let demons in people's life. And so, but what? I had an eye to see it right away and then check it right there at the door. And she took it back over there. I got finished talking. See, but anybody else, my partner would have been there, you know, who didn't know the things I knew about that stuff, nothing would have happened. They would have brought it in there, and I would have been in there wondering, what's wrong with this place? Why are we losing business? What's going on? What happened here? Somebody opened up a spiritual door and let a demon in. And it comes what to do nothing but to kill, steal, and destroy. And people are doing that in their lives and they're allowing their children to do it right now in the times that we're living in. That's throwing your children to the fire. They were literally doing it in Joshua's day. God wanted all those people to be destroyed. But now, spiritually, he can still do it. Once the person loses the spiritual authority over their children, then a whole lot of things could take place. When I first started this ministry, I was helping a whole lot of single parents. And most of the cases, if not all the cases, was they was borderline losing their children. One more step, they was going to lose their children. All eyes was on them. And so I started explaining to them, I said, you already lost your child. And now what took place in the spiritual realm is now manifesting into the natural realm, and now the state is fitting to take them. Now you can turn that around by repenting and asking God to forgive you and start changing your mind about a lot of different things you allow this environment, this climate, to pull you down into. The drug epidemic and so forth. And living loosely. I mean, if you stand in an Ambassador Hotel and you have children, next step, the state is going to come take them children, especially at that time when it was drug infested and every type of other wickedness and stuff that was taking place there. You see, and I'm just trying to show you how what the Bible is talking about then is still happening today. But they were still not having an eye to see it. So, it are them that practice divination. And my note says, the many different ways that opens up the door to the spiritual realm are observed clouds. Most translations, even the King James doesn't have that in there concerning observed clouds. But this is one of the things that they was taught on the other side of the flood. The fallen angels taught them how to observe clouds. And it's a form of witchcraft. And then it says, are a fortune teller, are a witch, are a charmer, are sorcery. And all these things amount to sorcery, which is pharmakia. The word pharmakia, get the word pharmacy from, says, which we get so many types of forms of drugs from. Sorcery. So it's still going on today. You go into a climate, go into a city, and they're practicing big time sorcery on the streets, selling drugs. And even now, living in a time where drugs is like kind of illegal, don't ask, don't tell thing, you know. And if you push the police to harass you about it, all they're going to do is give you a ticket. Now, unless you're selling and you got a pocket full of money and out there being obvious selling, and still they still don't want to deal with it. So drugs are kind of illegal. And so you have, you know, people that are selling drugs on the streets, they don't open up their pharmacies. And yeah, people are driving by, drive-through pharmacies, serving people. And you can go to any one of these drugstores, they have drive-through pharmacies. This is people on the street have drive-through pharmacies. It's all witchcraft. Say, no, come on, Pastor Fred, that's not witchcraft. Yes, it is. I was involved in it. I used to get like pounds and kilos of cocaine, powder, when rocks first came out. I had to cook it up. Had some pay somebody to cook it for me. And they'd get it, you know, get a bottle, pour the powder in it, pour the water in it, you know, and get a little touch of baking soda, a little touch of baking soda, and then put a fire up under it, start shaking it, and it starts boiling. The next thing you know, you got a rock. You got a big old rock, right? Huh? That's nothing but a witch contention. Had to add a little bit of this, a little bit of that, a little bit of this, a little bit of that. The way I used to get it, I used to have to cut it. So I had to add some vitamin B to it. Cut it up a little bit because it was too strong, you know. And a lot of people who like shooting it would come and try to get it from me before I cut it. And I cut it and said, no, you kill yourself with this. So I have to cut it. And they get it. This is a spoon one of my young people gave me. Got a little crown and stuff on it. But they get it. And they put the powder in there and they put, you know, hit it with water and they hit it and bring it to a boil. Then they get the syringe and they shoot it in them. What is that? That's witchcraft at its highest form. You go to a witch doctor and you have an evil spirit in you that you can't get out. And they're not going to cast it out since they deal with spirits and stronger the spirit, the better. They will try to get that spirit out of you to come and work for them. And they would make up some type of contagion. They would put something in a, and they would boil it, and they would put this and put that, and make it like it into a tea, and have you drink it. Mm-hmm. And it brings down the spiritual hedge, and they call that spirit out of you. So what I'm talking about, you can enter into go into a city that's been practicing the same thing that they was practicing in the day of Joshua, in the city that they went into, that God wanted Joshua to destroy everything in it, because they was practicing something that was abomination to God. Any type of sin that's an abomination to God, then you get saved, you ask Jesus Christ into your life, you best be listening to the way I preach, because that's the only way you're going to be set free. Uncut. You can't go sit in no church after you done lived out in the street life and lived a life that's an abomination to God, practicing modern witchcraft with drugs and modern idolatry with all the sexual stuff that you're doing, and think that you can accept Jesus Christ in your life and God's going to raise a magic wand on you, boost you okay. No, you done things that's abomination to him. You got to be delivered constantly for the rest of your Christian life. Every level of maturity, you got to get set free from something. And it says, our wizards are one who calls on the dead. I know it says, praying over and honoring ancestral spirits. And they do that in this nation and throughout the world. The Native Americans right now is activating all their ancestral way of worship. And they even have cartoons showing their children how to, so they don't forget how their ancestors used to worship demons. They lost this nation for worshiping demons. Like the children of Israel was taken into the promised land to destroy everybody in that land because they were worshiping demons. You see, if you don't understand, you can walk into an environment that they're doing one of those powwow things and whatever, and they don't open up a spiritual door. They're letting demons through. And you could go and visit this reservation or that reservation and pick up some jewelry and this and that and bring demonic stuff home with you. Because it's at its highest form right now, and they're activating all this stuff all over again. Why? Because the church done got ignorant. God gave them those governmental laws for them to keep. As long as they kept those laws, they're going to rise above the demonic power in the land. And when they didn't keep them, they lowered themselves down and their morals down, where the demons just saturated them. And in the most case, they never did turn back to God, children of Israel. They never did turn back to God, because they were saturated with demons. And God had to deal with them accordingly. Allowed them to go into captivity, into Babylon. And that same spirit of Babylon, you get into the book of Revelation, is still at work right now. Everything that we just read came out of Babylon. Everything that they're practicing in the promised land started at the Tower of Babel. Babylon, that became Babylon later on. And the children of Israel, when they was there, they started practicing the witchcraft of Babylon when they was in captivity. And God told Ezekiel to tell them that what he was going to do. He's going to bring a judgment on those that started practicing. And saying that practicing the witchcraft of Babylon, and start saying that, thus says God. God says this, God says that. And God said, I haven't said nothing that's coming out of their mouth. And we're living in the same time. The church, in most cases, turned over to the spirit of Babylon. Same spirit. And people are practicing, prophesying, laying hands on people out of that same spirit. Because why? They don't want to stand up. Jesus said, in my name, cast out the demons. Don't want to deal with the demons first. They want to go on to healing laying their hands on people, this and that. Yeah. There's a thing called transference of spirits. If the demon's still there, you might get a transference of spirit. I'm just trying to speak truth to you. You'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free, mold you, shape you into freedom. I'm not trying to scare you, I'm not trying to spook you. I'm just trying to tell you what the Word of God says. Now, you can take it for granted and continue, or you can allow God to change you. Allow the freedom to come. Allow the shaping and the molding to come. Now, I'm going to end with this verse in 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 23, the first king of Israel received the Holy Spirit in his life. Not like we do. 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 23. The first king of Israel received the Holy Spirit in his life. And the Holy Spirit stayed with him for a period of time. But as in the New Testament, when we ask Jesus Christ into our life, the Holy Spirit comes and he wakes up our spirit that's been dormant because of what Adam and Eve did. God said, the day you eat off that tree, you're going to die. And the Hebrew says, in dying, you would die. So it's a twofold death. The first death took place, God's breath, his spirit, went dormant into mankind. And man had to be led by his soul in the five senses, no longer by God's spirit. But Jesus Christ paid the price for the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, to come into us and wake up God's breath in us. And a circumcision of the heart take place. But with King Saul here, the first king of Israel, God allowed his Holy Spirit to be upon him and stay upon him as long as he would obey God. And the Holy Spirit was there to help him to obey God. But still, he rebelled. And one of the things the prophet Samuel told him because of his rebellion, says, for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. You see, when we rebel against God, it's just like we've been out there practicing witchcraft, been out there using drugs, or been out there, you know, going to the botanical shops and buying candles and getting the tarot cards done and getting the Ouija board and playing Ouija board games or paying to get the crystal ball read to us or palm read. When you rebel, it says, you pick up the same spirit. It says, for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. It says, and stubbornness as iniquity. So if you want to run around being stubborn, when you hear the word of God and don't let it move you, then it wakes up the generational propensity that's in you, iniquity, a bitterness in your soul that will keep you going back and being rebellious. So, and it's idolatry. Stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. And he tells him, because you have rejected the word. Because you rejected the word. He said, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. But you could do what? Reject the word. He says, because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he have also rejected you from being kings. Here in the New Testament, we are kings and priests before God. Everyone who accepts Jesus Christ into their life, it says in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, that we're a royal generation, a chosen people, royal as in king, a chosen priesthood, a chosen priesthood. So we're kings and priests, that verse says. In Revelation chapter 1, verse 5 and 6, it says, straight out tells you that you are a king and priest. But here you see in the New Testament that something could happen that could cause God to reject our being a king. A king is one that takes authority. You go into another city or whatever, and you're not going in with the authority of a king, then the enemy sees that. You're doing something that you cause God to reject you as being a king from the kingdom of heaven. Are you walking in ignorance that's causing God not to accept you as being a priest? A priest is one that served people and looking to bring people into the kingdom or what have you. And a king is one that could take his apostolic authority when he sees the enemy moving a certain way. So, but it says, For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as the sin of idolatry, because you have rejected the word. The Lord has rejected you. Everybody say, Lord Jesus,
Lord Jesus,
I thank you for coming into this world.
Coming into this world
in the flesh,
dying on the cross,
taking my sins,
sickness,
diseases,
pain,
curses, and soul ties
to the cross,
to hell. And you rose the third day, satisfied the claims of the justice
of the universe
for my justification. For my righteousness. I'm a righteous person now. In my spirit. In my soul. In my body. I have the spirit of truth in me that leads me into all truth and away from all lies. So therefore, devil, I'm no longer under your dominion. You're not my father. You're the father of lies. I'm of the truth now. God is my father. Jesus Christ is my Lord. His Holy Spirit is in me to lead me into all truth and mold me and shape me into the freedom God has for my life. In Jesus' name,
Amen.
Praise God. Praise God. Father, we thank you, Lord God. I thank you, Father God, that I know this word was hard, but Father God, we need to hear the hard word that's going to penetrate any dark areas that still remain in our soul.
Yes.
I ask that you allow it to do so in those who are under the sound of my voice tonight, those who will hear this in a way of video or CD, that it will break off their life and shake them and awake them to the principles and precepts of God. That they will walk in the newness of life that you desire for them. That they will know the truth, and the truth will make and shape and mold them into the freedom to be ambassadors. So wherever they go, they are representing the kingdom. And the power of the enemy is not overtaking them. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Bless the food, the hand that prepared it. Help us have good fellowship here tonight. Amen.
Amen.